Hi there. Are you tired of waiting forever for websites to load? Yeah, me too. That's why we are going to talk about rendering performance today. But before we get into the nitty-gritty details, let me set the scene with a little story. Imagine you are trying to book a vacation online, but every time you hit the search button, the page just takes forever to render the result. It's so frustrating that you just give up and go to a competitor website. Don't let that be your case. Let's learn how to avoid that fate and make sure your application is snappy. In this video, I will provide a clear and detailed explanation of the problem of poor rendering performance in an Angular application. I will use a real-world example and show techniques such as DevTools Performance Monitor and Web Performance Timeline Record to give a technical understanding of the issue. I will also provide step-by-step process for investigating and solving the problem. Ready for a performance boost? So gear up and get prepared to make your application run faster than a cheetah on Red Bull. So to get started, let's head to the browser and see a real-world case study. Here we have an application that displays the list of field sets. When the user clicks on a row, they can view its specific details, including a group of SES fields displayed as a ships list. By default, the first field is selected and highlighted in blue, allowing the user to easily view its attributes. The user can also check the details of other fields by clicking on them. Additionally, they can click on the Show All button to view the details of all the fields. However, I have noticed that displaying the details of all 12 fields in this example takes about 4 seconds to load in the browser. But don't worry, we are not defeated yet. Let's fire up DevTools and take a closer look at the performance metrics. DevTools Performance Monitor. In the top right corner of DevTools, I need to click on the 3 dots, select More Tools, and then Performance Monitor. This will provide me with charts that give insights into the CPU usage, JS heap size, DOM nodes, JS event listeners, and other performance metrics. By using the performance monitor, I can pinpoint the specific area of my application that are causing delays and work on improving them. Alright folks, let's hide the details of all these feeds by clicking again on the Show All button, which is in fact a toggle button, and then show just 2 SES feeds of the DLL field set. Things are heating up fast. There is a remarkable spike in the CPU usage. Let's head back to the destination field set and compare it to our DLL case. 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds. It takes a whopping 4 seconds to render the 12 forms associated with these 12 ECS fields. And that big block of yellow-lilac colors on the CPU usage chart reflects the cost of this epic rendering journey in terms of resources. Let's dive deeper into the performance with the help of the performance timeline record. First, let's go to the performance tab in DevTools, free up some memory by clicking on that little handy garbage collection button, and hit the start record button to prepare for some thrilling action. Now let's perform the scenario that's been given us trouble. I click on the Show All Details button for the 12 fields. Click again to hide them, then head over to the client field set to check out the details of its 12 SES fields. So I'm done. I will stop the record and check out the results. I see that it took a whopping 7 seconds for the browser to handle the rendering task shown in lilac, while scripting only took 2 seconds. The rendering task is all about the animation you see in the middle section here. And if I take a closer look at the first large colored block from the top chart, I can see that the browser was busy for about 3 seconds with animation and rendering the DOM of the 12 fields. Let's check out the second large block, and I see that the animation task took about 4 seconds. Now that we have these insights, it's time to head to the source code and fix this performance bottleneck. Checking the source code. In the template, I see two alternative DOM blocks. The first one will be rendered if only one field is selected and the variable open all fields is false. The second one will be rendered if the variable open all fields is true. It contains an ng for loop to show the template of the ECS field component and times. As you can see here, this component uses onPush change detection strategy, just like its parent ECS field set component does, which is in fact beneficial for web performance. Now let's dive into the HTML part of the ECS field component. Here we have a form of 27 matform fields, depending on the form state, whether it's in update or read mode, and whether a field is editable or not, the number of rendered matform fields could change. This means that to show the details of 12 ECS fields, the browser needs to check 324 matform fields and render part of them. But that's not all, because at the bottom of the form, there are some nested components like ships list, edit ships list, and ECS field load values. These components contain even more matform fields and matships. Here in the ships list component, you can see that we have ng for loop to show a list of labels in div. And in the edit ships list component, we are using matship grid and matship row inside of it. So the challenge now is to find ways to increase the rendering speed of all these DOM blocks. Solution 1. Mat native control. In the Angular material documentation, I have found the potential solution. It's about using native elements inside of matform field. According to the documentation, native control have several performance, accessibility, and usability advantages. Here is the difference between how a native and non-native control looks. So to give this solution a try, I imported mat input module and need to add the mat native control attribute to all the form's elements in the ECS field component. I'm done now. Let's head to the browser and open DevTools to generate a performance timeline record for the scenario of displaying all the fields of the client field set. So unfortunately, it doesn't look like there is improvement in the performance. The browser is still struggling with the rendering task for a few seconds before displaying the final result. Let's double check the performance monitor. So it confirms our findings. It looks like our first solution was a bit of a flop. But don't fret, there are plenty more performance solutions to make the user experience smoother. Second solution, virtual scrolling. All right, let's dive into solution number 2. It's like a magic trick where we make all those ECS fields disappear except the ones that are currently in view. Virtual scrolling can efficiently display a large amount of data by only rendering the items that are currently visible in the viewport. For the implementation, I'll be using the CDK virtual scroll viewport component provided by the Angular Material CDK package. I need to define a virtual scrolling area and bind it to an array of data items using the items input. This component will automatically handle rendering the items that are currently visible in the viewport and updating the DOM as the user scrolls. Let's implement this solution. The virtual scroll area should contain the ng for loop wrapping the n ECS field components. So I need to replace ng for with CDK virtual scroll To make sure the scroll area has the right size, I will add the Tailwind CSS classes H16 and H24. And don't forget to specify the item size attribute in the Cheetah virtual scroll viewport element to let the virtual scroll know how much space each item should take up. Okay, let's see the result. I will check the 12 fields in the client field set. And voila, the details appear instantly with no lag or delay because just part of it is rendered at the beginning, and whenever I scroll down, further items will be rendered. Let's take a look at the performance monitor. Okay, it's much better. The CPU consumption jumps just for a moment, then it returns to the normal level. Let's try it out with the 22 fields in the file field set. Same story, no lag or delay, and it's even comparable with showing one field at a time. But before you jump into the virtual scrolling bandwagon, keep in mind that it may not be the best fit for every situation. In this case study, for example, we don't want to have a second vertical scroller. We want, in fact, the same old layout, just without latency. So carefully consider the trade-offs before implementing this solution in your own application. So since the previous solution didn't work, I will try another one. Instead of virtual scroll, I will opt for async rendering based on RexJS. Basically, the solution is using RexJS and its operator in order to return a lazy array instead of returning all the items of the array at once. In this article, you can find an explanation about the solution. So we need to define a function like this one, lazy array, and then in our observable where the items are stored, we need to add pipe and then call lazy array inside of it. Let's go back to my code. I have copied this code snippet here. As you can see, we need to define a parameter called concurrency here, and it's used in buffer count, which means we are processing n requests in a batch. In our case, we are processing 2 requests in a batch. I can change this concurrency to 5 if I want to return 5 elements on each iteration. And then we have concat map. Here I have done a slight modification in comparison to the solution used by the author. The author has used scheduled off and then animation frame scheduler as a scheduler for it, but this didn't work for my case. I think that the value for this animation frame scheduler was not returned correctly. That's why I just removed it and used off value. Now we have our function. I need to go to the point where I get the list of the fields, which is here. In this component, I am retrieving the observable from the service. Let's pipe and call lazy array. Okay, and then in the template, I am giving this observable to this input, which will deliver it to this ACS field set. And here there is an iteration of this list. Here is my input. So let's see on the browser now how it looks like. Let's open the performance monitor and go to client. Okay, here we have to click on all the fields. So as I can see, there is no performance optimization. And it looks like that at this point, when we are in this ACS field component, all the items of the array are already there. Here we are displaying, in fact, the fields in 2 different sections. Here on the top, we are displaying them with ship list, and all of them should be displayed at the same time. Like here in file, we have 22 fields. I would like to maintain this behavior, and just after clicking on all fields, I want to show the details on a lazy way or progressively. So I need to do some modifications. Let's remove the lazy array from the parent component and go to the child component. Here I would like to add an observable called lazy fields, and I will use it in this section. Only when the button open all fields is clicked and this variable is set to true. But on the top, where I am displaying the list of the ships, I would like to maintain the same behavior. No lazy load here is wanted. Let's go back. After defining my observable, I need to go to the toggle method, and when the user clicks on the toggle button, I will set the value for this observable. So it should receive of these fields, then pipe, then lazy array. But this is not quite correct, because when the user click on the toggle button, maybe he wants to hide the details and not always to show the details. That's why I will check if the value of this variable is true. Then I will do it this way. Otherwise, I will just do it so, which means my observable does not need to have a lazy array in it. So let's adjust the template now. So here I need to call the observable and the async pipe. Let's check the result. Here we have our client field set. We have all the list of the fields in this ships list. And when I click on all fields, as you can see, there is a progressive load. That's why the scroller was jumping. I can try it again. With the file field set. Here we have more fields, 22. Keep an eye on the scroller. Yeah, as you can see, so this is due to the lazy loading. So let's check the performance now. We need to open the DevTools, and here we go. So the browser was busy with the rendering. This lapse of time is longer than it was before, but the responsiveness of the UI is optimized. Let's change the concurrency to 1, for example. Okay, here we have 4 fields. Maybe you have already noticed it. That we get just one field and the other one was received afterwards. Yeah. So here we have achieved our goal, but I would like to show you something that you should be careful about. So let's say that I haven't set my observable here, but in the on change here. So after receiving the fields, I try to initialize my observable. Let's see how it looks like now on the browser. So let's click on client. This is the first time that I click on the toggle button. So it works as expected. Let's click on it again. All the details disappear. Let's click a second time on the toggle button. And now, as you can see, we have the performance problem again. And the reason for that is that the observable value is already set here and the lazy loading is already done. All the items are on the observable and they are not reloaded again on a lazy way. That's why it's not quite correct to do this logic in this block. Let me show it to you with the file field set. Okay, this is the first time, it's okay. Let's hide the details and then click on it again. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 seconds. It took 6 seconds in order to get these details. And this is the original rendering performance problem. So be careful about such cases. We need to repeat the lazy loading whenever the user clicks on the toggle button. Let's do it again here. And this is the correct way.
So that's it, guys. I hope that was helpful. If you liked the video, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. And see you next time.